principal funding for Rights and Wrongs, the Human Rights Television Series, has been provided by the John D. and Catherine T. MacArthur Foundation, the Body Shop Foundation, and the Aaron Diamond Foundation. Globalvision presents a new program on the cutting edge of change.
I, William Jefferson Clinton, do solemnly swear.
This week, a report card on the Clinton administration's human rights record.
I think Clinton gets about a D in terms of, so far, complying with some of his campaign promises.
Is there a new vision? Is this president making a difference? We'll talk with the president who made human rights his issue.
Every ambassador that represented me in any foreign country was my personally designated human rights representative.
We'll also have a video diary shot under fire in Sarajevo and a report from Sri Lanka.
Leonard Peltier sleeps in a breeze.
And in our culture segment, a song that asks, where is the justice for Leonard Peltier, a Native American whose trial and conviction are now in question?
His crime was tradition.
All this on Rights and Wrongs, the television magazine of human rights. In New York, Charlene Hunter Gault.
For this broadcast, we turn our attention to Washington, D.C. The policy positions the United States government takes or doesn't take on human rights make an important difference. U.S. human rights policies help to establish an international standard of conduct and promote respect for basic rights. They help to define who America's friends are and with whom the U.S. will do business. To the abused populations of oppressive regimes, strong U.S. rights policies can provide a significant hope for change. So when Governor Bill Clinton campaigned as a champion of human rights, change seemed assured and human rights organizations celebrated. That mood is turning critical. Now, amid growing human rights crises worldwide, it's appropriate to take a measure of the new administration's progress in setting a clear human rights agenda. Our cover story offers an interim report card examining whether President Clinton's promises have become policies. Last year, when Bill Clinton was a candidate for president, he made a lot of promises about human rights emergencies around the world. About Bosnia, where massacres, rape, torture, and ethnic cleansing seem to present a clear moral choice, Clinton said, "History has shown that you can't allow the mass extermination of people and just sit by and watch it happen." About Haiti, where democratically elected President Jean-Bertrand Aristide was being kept from power by a military junta, and thousands of Aristide's supporters were risking their lives to seek asylum in the United States, Clinton said, "I want to reaffirm my opposition to the Bush administration's cruel policy of returning Haitian refugees to their oppressors in Haiti without a fair hearing for political asylum." And about China, where 3 years after the slaughter in Tiananmen Square, the ruling elite maintains power through strict control and brutal repression, Clinton said, "We have a right to ask a country that has a $15 billion trade surplus with the United States not to export goods made with prison labor, but to observe basic human rights." Human rights groups who complained of being ignored at best during the 12 years of the Reagan-Bush administrations welcomed Clinton's election.
I, William Jefferson Clinton, do solemnly swear.
Pleased by the administration's willingness to support human rights initiatives at the UN, they are still disappointed and frustrated. After just a few months in office, President Clinton is being sharply criticized by the same people who once hailed him. Holly Burkhalter of Human Rights Watch.
I think Clinton gets about a D in terms of, so far, complying with some of his campaign promises.
Jim O'Dea of Amnesty International.
He hasn't yet gotten into gear. He's not really in the driver's seat when it comes to human rights.
You place your left hand on the Bible.
Even Jimmy Carter, the last president to make human rights a priority, is critical of Clinton's performance thus far.
But I don't think we have publicized or made clear to the world that we are the strong champions of human rights, and hope that other nations will join us in a phalanx of commitment to that same basic moral principle.
The problem, say human rights activists, is that President Clinton has failed to live up to candidate Clinton's promises.
President Clinton has made a lot of promises, has produced an image of concern on human rights. There's a sense that he may believe in these issues, but he hasn't gotten down to the business of human rights.
Human rights groups are specifically critical of Clinton's promises on Haiti, China, and most urgently, Bosnia.
The human rights atrocities that have occurred in the 4 months that the United States sat on the sidelines and did zip are so horrendous that one just weeps to think about the failure, really.
Pierre Sane is the Secretary General of Amnesty International.
We are disappointed in the administration's slowness in taking decisive action on some of the human rights issues for which we have expressed serious concern. One is the treatment of Haitian refugees. The other one is the treatment of Haitians HIV sufferers who are detained in Guantanamo.
Michael Posner of the Lawyers Committee for Human Rights.
If Haitians are picked up by the Coast Guard and they have a fear of persecution that's well-founded, we have an international law obligation not to return them to Haiti. That's something that I think needs to be respected, and the administration, I think, has made a big mistake by essentially abandoning them.
There are so many pressing concerns in China, and yet one feels that the approach of the Bush administration is really still the approach that's being taken. They're not prepared to come out and say the following areas of torture, of unfair trials, the treatment of Tibetans, of the massive violations in China, are squarely on the agenda.
And in my view, that's not human rights policy. The Chinese feel like they're home free. They've made no human rights concessions because they haven't been asked to make any human rights concessions. And if you ask me, that's Bush policy. That sounds like George Bush's policy on China.
But the nominations of Morton Halperin as the Assistant Secretary of Defense for Democracy and Human Rights and John Shattuck as the Assistant Secretary of State for Human Rights are encouraging to Burkhalter.
I think the Clinton administration has a lot of promise. And I base that on the quality of some of the appointments that he's made. Even though they're not in office yet, they've been named, and they are people of integrity. Some of them have had long years of experience in the human rights field.
Neither Halperin nor Shattuck, who have yet to be confirmed, would comment, nor would Shattuck's superior, Timothy Wirth, the Undersecretary of State for Global Affairs. President Clinton has yet to respond to a long-standing request for an interview with Rights and Wrongs, and when we asked the White House Office of Communications to provide anyone from the Clinton administration who could respond to the criticisms raised by human rights groups, no one was made available. Along with criticism, human rights activists also have suggestions for actions the president might take.
What the Clinton administration needs to do is look for the early warning signs and take action early. Bring up our concerns with governments that are taking these actions to foment and inflame conflict and hold them to task and use our aid relationship to leverage and to pressure and to speak out and denounce and to report on before these things reach the proportions of a Bosnia or a Somalia or a Liberia.
The Clinton administration has to send a clear signal that human rights is part of our foreign policy and that future relations with the United States depend on taking human rights seriously.
But taking human rights seriously can be costly, and the human rights community isn't sure that President Clinton is willing to pay for candidate Clinton's promises.
My sense with President Clinton is he wants to get off cheap with human rights. He wants to be able to say that he is going to do it, but he doesn't want to pay the price of the real human rights hero.
If President Clinton's administration has yet to clearly define its human rights agenda, the last Democratic president is probably remembered most for his stand on these issues. Recently, I spoke with Jimmy Carter at the United Nations, where he was working to promote the upcoming UN World Conference on Human Rights this June. I began by asking him what it meant to be a human rights president.
Every ambassador that represented me in any foreign country was my personally designated human rights representative. Every embassy of the U.S. all over the world was a haven for people who suffered human rights abuses within that country. And I got regular reports before I met with leaders or when I communicated with leaders about how their human rights policies were being implemented or not implemented. And anyone who came to visit me or who dealt with the United States asking for aid or asking for cooperation or even partnership, I knew that human rights would be on the agenda. I wish that all of the countries would do that.
What about now in terms of...
The problem is that and I've learned a lot since I left the White House, I have to say, in this respect. You know, I think our own definition of human rights in the United States is too narrow. Every country has a strong tendency to identify human rights in such a way that it's most convenient for them. The problem with human rights in our country that are not very important are the ones that we emphasize. We don't really infringe basically on freedom of religion or freedom of speech or freedom of assembly or freedom of the press. But walk down the streets in New York, just a few blocks from here, and you find people sleeping on the streets without homes. The right to shelter is a basic human right. The right to adequate food is a basic human right. The right to be treated fairly and equally in the justice system is a basic human right. And the right, I think, to economic development, which is so needed in third world countries, is a basic human right. We need to broaden our definition of human rights and not just preach to others from a very small foundation that's very convenient for us.
This is the first time in 25 years there's been a World Human Rights Conference. Why now? Is there a new sense of urgency, or is it just an idea whose time has come again?
Well, there are two or three reasons. One is that the Cold War is now over, and there's a new belief that the United Nations can emerge as a much more viable and effective instrument for universally identifying human rights crimes, correcting those that exist, and preventing others. Also, there's been a rapid increase in abuse around the world. We now have four times as many refugees as existed when I became president. And in the first 4 months of this year, there were three times as many reports of human rights abuses to the United Nations Center in Geneva as in all of 1992. And the number of wars in the world now are the highest in history. And within the war zones, all of them are civil wars, the human rights crimes are very high. So I would say the reason for it is it's long overdue, 25 years since the last one in Tehran. Secondly, to look at the United Nations as a potential instrument for effectively dealing with human rights abuses. How do you identify obstacles that exist now, and how do you overcome those obstacles, and to get a world consensus on moving forward with a much more effective human rights approach?
When you look at the events in the former Yugoslavia and the debate over nations, among nations, about what to do, and also the fact that, as you alluded to, half of the world's people are victims of human rights abuses, how do you assess the political will to do anything about human rights abuses and to protect human rights at this moment in history?
I think the collective will of the world community is there. Otherwise, we wouldn't have the World Conference being convened. It'll be a highly attended and I would say perhaps one of the most controversial conferences ever held in history.
Why is that?
Because there's such a sharp difference of opinion about what is human rights.
What are the demarcations of the difference?
Well, to put the demarcation in one word, it's universality. Will the world community adopt a universal declaration of human rights that will be enforced? Or do you have to realize that there are cultural differences among nations so that they can treat human rights in a different way? One very obvious question would be, how do you deal with women? You know, is there a universal commitment to equality of women? Whereas in some countries, their culture, their religion, puts women in a secondary position. That has to be addressed.
Also, traditionally, hasn't it been the case that there was a demarcation between, say, torture and political prisoners and that of economic rights?
Exactly.
Is that going to be on this agenda?
It certainly will. Development is a word that is used. And I think this is where the rich Western nations have got to learn a lesson. You know, we can't just say people have a right to speak and a right to religion and a right to the press, a right to assembly. We've also got to realize that people have a right to eat and to have a place to sleep and to have some modicum of an education. and to have a chance for economic growth and progress. So the third world countries, many of whom are desperately poor, believe that development ought to be part of human rights. So I think that all of us are going to learn from this. And you can't just have a few rich nations or powerful nations preaching to the rest of the world. You've got to have a shared commitment to a common approach on what is human rights, how should human rights be enforced.
Well, President Carter, thank you.
It's been a pleasure, always, to be with you.
In the weeks to come, the rights of women, born of the brutality in Bosnia, women of the world are calling for justice.
We demand peace, justice, no more war, no more rape.
Rights and Wrongs will also examine the rights of workers in Mexican border towns, the indigenous rights of native Hawaiians, and will profile human rights heroes from a priest working in the jungles of Brazil to Bernadette Devlin in Northern Ireland.
Very few of the rights that Americans take for granted are actually enjoyed by citizens here, and in fact are legislated against.
And China. What has changed in the 3 years since the tragedy in Tiananmen Square? We'll have a special report. You are watching Rights and Wrongs, Human Rights Television. Each week at this time, news and global perspectives you don't see elsewhere.
Our weekly rights reel offers footage and perspectives rarely seen elsewhere. This week, as the military conflict in Bosnia preoccupies the world, we feature part of an unusual video diary produced under fire in Sarajevo. We also talk with two outspoken writers, one Serbian, the other Bosnian, who were honored by PEN, a writers group that defends the right to free expression, a basic human right. We begin our report on the streets of Sarajevo.
These are the sounds of a city under siege, a military salute to one of Sarajevo's defenders, a burial ritual, an everyday event.
Ali ono odjednom, eto, od te granate, odjednom se život preokrene, ono, skroz, umjesto da budem sad tamo i ono, Alan dođe, sve normalno, ono, sjedite, pričate. Sad ovako, rat je tako.
But before Adisa's lover departed, they had agreed to marry, and so they did. No champagne, only tears.
What do you want to do? A di se dali svojom slobodnom voljom stupate u brak sa odsutnim čustvom ćelema.
Tako, pošto je to bila i njegova i moja želja, a nije nam se stvarno. Tako sam, eto, tog dana kad su ga sahranili, prije sahrane, smo se venčali, ono.
I think that the world is missing point because it didn't pay attention to what was going on before the war started.
All the armies should be disarmed, and the patrolling, the militia, the police patrolling should be done by the United Nations.
This situation cannot be solved with maps, with any solution based on ethnic principles.
This war has succeeded in some of its goals, because one of the goals was to provoke exactly this feeling of mutual hatred and the sense of incapability of living together.
These are the Tamil Tigers, a separatist guerrilla force which says it's fighting to protect the rights of the Tamil minority in Sri Lanka, the island nation off the coast of India, occupied by more than 17 million people. The man they'd been fighting to topple was hardline president Ranasinghe Premadasa, pictured here by Sri Lanka television during the last hours of his life. Critics say Premadasa, blown up on May 1st by a suicide bomber reportedly linked to the militant Tigers, was an authoritarian, who dominated the volatile political scene, the cremation of the president and the assassination of the leader of the opposition just a week earlier has traumatized the country, where the conflict between the Tamil ethnic minority and the Sinhalese majority has cost more than 20,000 lives, according to Freedom House.
Civilian massacres are routine on both sides.
Author Bill McGowan, who studied Sri Lanka, says Tamil grievances are legitimate.
There is a general legitimacy to a lot of the claims that they fear for their lives and their safety and because of the human rights abuses that committed against young Tamil men by the Sinhalese-dominated counterinsurgency forces.
Human rights groups say torture and ill-treatment by the police and military are common. A Sri Lanka government representative declined to be interviewed by Rights and Wrongs, and a spokesperson dismissed these reports of abuses as fabrications. For Rights and Wrongs, this is Philip Tomlinson.
Violence between Hindus and Muslims simmers in India, where the country's most popular movie star, Sanjay Dutt, was recently arrested and later released in connection with terrorism linked to the ethnic violence. Azra Shafi, who was with Dutt, brought us the story she says she was encouraged to publicize by an FBI agent who debriefed her upon her return to the U.S.
The gentleman I spoke to at the FBI gave me a list of people that we should talk to in a couple of newspapers. He discussed the Washington Post, Rights and Wrongs, and a couple of other television shows.
Sanjay Dutt is India's matinee idol, a kind of Kevin Costner, Arnold Schwarzenegger combination. He's half Muslim, half Hindu, but reached out to Muslims who came under attack from Hindu fundamentalists during recent riots.
They were slaughtering small children. They were raping and beating women, children in front of their parents, in front of their spouses.
Dutt's father, a member of parliament known as Bombay's Cary Grant, was assaulted and his family threatened. Dutt was given an assault rifle and grenades, supposedly for his protection. The police stepped in, suspecting links to a shadowy Muslim drug dealer who allegedly financed terrorist activities.
I was afraid that if they put him in jail, that the police were going to interrogate him and beat him till he was either going to die or go mad, as has been the case with other people that they've interrogated.
Shafi says it took mass pressure to get Dutt released. Still under investigation, Dutt was threatened in prisons that Amnesty International has condemned for torture. Shafi's greatest fear is the spread of ethnic hatred.
It's going on everywhere. And as small as the world's becoming today with faxes and lasers and this and that, that's how much closer we're getting to killing our neighbors too, and they're getting to killing us.
Rights and Wrongs welcomes your written comments and suggestions. You can also order a transcript for $5 or a video cassette for $24.95 by writing to the Global Center, P.O. Box 311, Radio City Station, New York, New York, 10101. Send checks or money orders only. Credit card holders call 1-800-541-2535.
Thanks for joining us. This week, we welcome new viewers overseas who will be watching Rights and Wrongs on Super Channel, which broadcasts in Western and Eastern Europe, including parts of the former Soviet Union. Human rights issues have their advocates everywhere, including the world of culture. An imprisoned Native American leader, Leonard Peltier, has been the center of controversy for nearly two decades. Convicted of killing two FBI agents in a standoff growing out of protests at an Indian reservation, he's become a symbol of injustice to some and to others of fair punishment for a dastardly crime. His conviction is under appeal in the courts and also in Little Steven's music video that we offer this week to show how the cultural arena has become a new forum for the human rights debate. This song is called Where is the Justice for Leonard Peltier?
Spoke and we cried, and the evidence is put in there. Was the liberty falsified? The government spends a lot of money,
spends a lot of money,
to keep the red man quiet. He should say what he wants to say. It is time we listen. He should pray where he wants to pray without that. 45 Pine Ridge Reservation. Two FBI trespass Lakota Nation. Looking for trouble, they're only waiting outside. And trouble they brought some. They were pawns in a big game for stolen minerals and tools. They were sacrificed in profit's name. And what would you do as you stare into the face of the genocide of your people? Put yourself in the place of BLM.